Hi there, welcome everybody. Thank you for taking the time to come. I'm Rob Merriweather, I'm the Group Technology Director for BAE Systems. Here with some colleagues across the breadth of our business to talk about our integrated autonomy approach. So just like quick introductions.
So good afternoon, I'm Ian Minton. I work in the air sector and I'm the Delivery Director of Technology and Capability.
Good afternoon, my name's Dave Quick and I look after the underwater battlespace and autonomy portfolio within the maritime and land sector.
Good afternoon, Mark Todd, I am the head of C5 products within the digital intelligence business.
Thank you. So within what we're going to talk about today, the increasing importance of autonomy and the challenges that brings in the current and the future battlespace. We've all seen huge increase in the use of uncrewed assets. We're seeing those platforms, those assets used for a range of roles from logistics through to ISR, surveillance, reconnaissance, ranging right the way through now to delivery of lethal effect in the battle space. And there's no doubt that in those roles, they've been incredibly effective. They've led to new tactics. They've led to new tactics for countermeasures. But they also bring a number of challenges in terms of the effective operation of those systems in theater. So from our perspective, it's really trying to understand, in parallel with the capability that these platforms can deliver, what are the challenges that we need to overcome in order to make them effective. So the challenges these platforms face, there's a huge amount of electronic warfare, trying to disrupt the signals communications, trying to disrupt the command and control. If you just think about things at the simple level, when we take the human operator away from the platform, we need to re-establish some method of control. Where that's done remotely, that's a communications link that is a vulnerability. And also the effect that electronic warfare can have on things that we rely on for navigation, so GPS, etc., whether that's jamming the GPS or whether that's spoofing the GPS to make you think that you're somewhere different to where you are. We also, when we look at remote-controlled assets, the control of those is manually intensive. So often we're still looking at one-to-one management from an operator to a drone throughout the operation. That operator needs to be in a safe and secure location because they don't have the situational awareness of their local environment. They're often immersed in the situational environment of the platform that they're controlling. There's then the challenges of integration across these assets. So if we look at coordinated action and how we coordinate more than one platform to deliver a common mission goal, how do we share the status? How do we share the mission status? How do we share the command and control of disparate platforms, different systems to achieve those common outcomes? And then there's the ongoing resilience of those systems. So whether that's resilience of the supply chain, whether that's resilience of the underlying technologies that sit within them, when we start to look at artificial intelligence embedded within platforms, there are ways of disrupting or fooling that artificial intelligence. We need to stay very aware of the operational challenges that the adversaries will throw to prevent these systems from becoming effective. So within BAE Systems, we focused really heavily on how do we increase the capabilities we can provide to our customers, and you'll see each of my colleagues talk about a range of platforms that we're putting forwards. But how do we do that within an architecture that resolves some of those challenges and allows us to progress capability at pace? So we've developed a framework which walks through each of those stages. So how we understand the situational awareness picture, how we bring in information from multiple assets into a coordinated view of the battle space, how we increase the automation of planning. So we can now, once we've understood the effect we want to have, we can task and plan the missions for assets much more quickly to increase that agility and that speed. How we then roll forwards into the dynamic mission management. So we had an initial plan, but the situation has changed. We've lost assets, there's new threats, mission goals might change. How we then put that layer of agility. how we overlay all of those elements on a deployable network, which is sufficiently resilient, robust, configurable to be able to share the information between assets, and then how that rolls finally out into the payloads that provide the mission capability on those platforms, and the enabling platforms that transport that payload to where it needs to be to have the effect that it needs to have. So we've taken very much a holistic view of that whole system. We've been very conscious of where we need to put the functional brakes in that system to allow it to be open and configured to operate with existing equipment that is already in the inventory or new equipment coming from different sources. And a lot of effort into where it's important to keep the integration tight for things like safety cases and safety critical features, but equally where to keep the systems open such that it can be configurable and adaptable in the field. So that's the structure that we work through. As a company, we're developing capabilities in all elements of this, from integrated intelligence systems that leverage the latest in AI to draw insights from complex pictures, out through to autonomous control systems that can be integrated onto a range of different platforms to deliver that platform control, out to the platforms and the payloads themselves that deliver the mission effect. So that's the strategic construct, that's the approach we're taking as a company. I'll now hand over to each of my colleagues in turn will talk through those elements from the perspectives of their businesses.
Thank you, Rob. So BAE Systems at FalconWorks, which is where I work, it's our new centre for advanced and agile research and technology development. And it's really looking at how do we develop those partnerships? How do we work with academia, research organisations, SMEs and governments to develop that wider range of development concepts and really touch on what Rob has talked about in terms of capabilities and understanding how they go forwards. And it's a natural fit of looking at how that collaborates across the BAE enterprise and key markets, whether that's through lines of business, through partnerships, or looking at things in different ways. So we've been investing to accelerate the availability of autonomous systems for our global defense customers for a long time, in all domains, in current and future operating environments. And we're developing solutions to give that full spectrum of air power effects through autonomous collaborative platforms, providing a range, payload, and either disposable or attritable price point availability. We recognize also that there's a key capability requirement for customers and a growing area of interest. And we continue to evolve our thinking and our collaboration activities across the whole industrial base in order to find solutions to enhance that capability for current Air Force mixes and understand those foundations as this future spiral development moves forwards for the future. And we're developing these autonomous collaborative platforms rapidly because they need to support the human Typhoon pilots in the near future. They're able to perform missions, fly ahead of crewed platforms, explore contested areas, and take greater risks so that the pilot doesn't need to. And they're being designed with advanced electromagnetic warfare and weapons payloads. That allows the pilot or a ground-based station communicating via satellite to command them at range and carry out complex missions. So the concept options that we're developing now are there to benefit today's pilots, but also will become part of the future combat air system working alongside Tempest in the future. Another example of the autonomous platforms is the T-150. That's operational now, it's being used in various logistics duties amongst others, and has been extensively tested by the Royal Navy. As of today, they're remotely operated, but we plan with further testing to show how they could navigate autonomously and as part of the work that Rob outlined earlier. And customers have this product now, and it's teaching us and them a lot of their operation in really contested environments. Moving on now to the more powerful T-650. That's now in development. It's really an effective piece of kit. It can carry payloads up to 300 kilograms and able to carry out a number of roles. Casualty evacuation, so developing a pod to remove casualties from the battlefield more quickly, which increases their chance of survival. Weapon payload delivery, used on a ship that should rapidly drop weapons such as depth charges or torpedoes, something that would currently require a helicopter. Or logistics, carrying supplies to the front line. It's a deeply hazardous mission, So this could autonomously drop food, water, ammunition, medical supplies to frontline outposts without putting people at risk. As this is a higher value UAV, it's also built with greater resilience to EM warfare, so that it can able to host autonomous architecture and enable it to operate in comms or even GPS denied environments. Our development platform for the T650, called the T600, which is pictured here, took part last year in a NATO multi-domain operations trial called NETMUS. It dropped a torpedo connected to the ship's combat management system, proving that autonomy does work and how that can come through. So now I'll hand over to Dave Quick to take through the maritime and land areas.
Yeah, thank you. So in the maritime and land domain, we've got products, autonomous products across several domains. Land, sea, undersea, and also in air through our Australian colleagues. So just to continue the air theme for a while, I want to introduce you to a new air vehicle that's coming out of our Australian business. Strix is a new long-endurance AUV. What's different is its unique combination of the flexibility that can be gained by vertical takeoff and landing capability, but also combined with the endurance you get from a fixed-winging aircraft. The wings also fold, so it fits in a container, which makes it ideal for providing a long-range air power capability to platforms, to ships that otherwise wouldn't be able to provide that service. We're planning to take Strix into its initial air trials later on this year, and that's from a concept from only about a year ago. Back to the maritime and land domain itself, some of the additional benefits of the common approach that Rob outlined at the top of the presentation is that the high level of modularity that this provides allows us to introduce a really fast pace of development and also introduce a high level of flexibility into the solution. Here you can see the P-38 attack craft here. It's actually a third-party built fast attack craft built by an Omani company, into which we've installed our autonomous brain, Nautomate. In doing so, we've removed the need for crew and made the platform ready for accepting a whole range of payload configurations as required for the customer to go and conduct a number of autonomous operations that they desire to do. It's shown here in this illustration with the maritime vehicle arrest system, which is a safe way of disabling other threat vessels. We've started with this intentionally to show that autonomous products doesn't necessarily mean the physical boat or airframe or even land vehicle, but it's also the autonomous systems that provide that capability into those platforms. Just moving on to Nautomate then. So Nautomate is our autonomous maritime solution, and it's the heart of our products on the water and also under it. Like the air products that have just been introduced, we're building them to be interoperable from the outset across domains, sharing data and using common command and control software components. Just touch on some of the Nautomate features to draw your attention to those. So Nautomate comes with a compact command and control suite that offers an optimized and intuitive user experience. And in doing so, it reduces the training burden and also cognitive load on the user. It provides the ability to accept mission plugins in response to the customer's need to quickly adapt mission goals and also to reconfigure those assets in that autonomous network quickly to achieve those revised goals. Nautomate is secure and it's future-proofed by the use of these plugins. This allows rapid integration of new system hardware, such as effectors and sensors, or perhaps plugins to give specific autonomous mission behavior, or even just quickly enhance the software to provide enhanced algorithms. It also combines inputs from different sensors to increase the accuracy and the integrity of its own surrounding world model. And it actually mimics the way that humans consider potential collisions and identifies safe avoidance maneuvers. Through this approach, Nautomate has demonstrated itself equally comfortable either conducting operations above or below the water. Hearn is our extra large autonomous underwater vehicle, and it's now commencing our sea trials, period of sea trials. It draws upon our multi-domain and military experience, and it brings together payload integration and effect delivery with mission planning, power and propulsion, and secure communications in the kind of structure that Rob outlined at the top of the presentation. And it provides this as an adaptive AUV solution with the capability of delivering really complex underwater battlespace operations. With its flexible design, HERN brings a new military capability which enables navies to cover more of the underwater battlespace than they've ever been able to do before. And positioning HERN right at the forefront of that battlespace, it removes the reliance on and the risk to larger platforms and critical resources, whilst also offering new capabilities that wouldn't be available through crewed assets. And also, I'll draw your attention to the Pacific 24 autonomous RIB. Now, this was initially developed by BAE under contract by the UK Royal Navy to convert BAE's staple RIB into an autonomous version for military operations. And that was done as part of the Navy X Autonomy and Lethality Accelerator program. It became the world's first naval vessel to be awarded Lloyd's Register for Unmanned Marine System Certification for both its design and its construction. It's now fully enabled by Nautomate. The Pacific 24 Autonomous RIB represents the latest incarnation of this really capable sea boat. As with the P-38, you can see on this slide, these examples prove that our autonomy solution is agnostic about the platform that it sits within, and that really is what makes it so flexible. P-38 is the latest and a great example of this, but there'll be more collaborations in the future. Back to Australia, where we're moving really fast with autonomy in the land domain. We've worked with the Australian Army on exercises involving crewed vehicles alongside several M113 armoured vehicles that we've now retrofitted to be autonomous. In the top left, you can see the vehicles. Now, they're an older armoured vehicle, but they're still very capable. Fitting autonomy and therefore removing the need for onboard crew has given them a new lease of life. We've demonstrated their utility and their usefulness in a range of surveillance and logistics operations. You can see in the picture there that our engineer is setting up the system before they were then set on their own to go and reach for a specified location. And they were given historic satellite imagery that they then combined with onboard sensor feeds to determine their own path, all the while avoiding obstacles and each other. The Australian Army has called this a great success and one that's spurring them on to do more work in this area. There's thousands of these M113s around the globe, and this is a fantastic use for them going into the future. As you can see, we've got quite a wide range of products, all of which have been developed in coordination with our central autonomy team. So they're all interoperable by design. I'll hand over now to my digital intelligence colleague, Mark Todd, to tell you a little bit more about his part of the business.
Thank you, Dave. So digital intelligence plays an important role in that whole autonomy structure. And from our perspective, what we're looking to do is connect those platforms and those systems to allow the data to be shared across the battle space. And for the purpose of this discussion, I'm going to focus in on three areas of work that we're doing. So the first is the networking, so how do we connect those together? The second will then be around cyber and electromagnetic activity. And then finally, I'm going to touch a little piece on payload development and payload integration. So I'm going to start with the network. So currently we're building the next generation of tactical wide area network for the British Army. So this follows on from capability that we delivered back in 2012 and is in service today. This will provide the core backbone network, the evolved digital backbone, into the land domain. And we'll integrate today's mobile tactical networks operating down to the tactical edge and out onto uncrewed platforms. This is really important. It's like broadband for the battlefield. It provides you those pipes that you need to pass that data back into the wider system and system as systems. We're building Trinity on a product called NetViper. And NetViper is a software-defined network. It is built on software, but done in a way that allows it to be plug-and-play and self-discovery as it builds that network. We've taken this and taken the principles of autonomy and ensuring that it is open and built to military standards. And in this case, that is the NATO Federated Mission Network standards. And we demonstrated interoperability last month in Poland at the NATO Coalition Warrior Interoperability Exercise. We're involving that NetViper capability and extending it to provide that modular network concept down to the tactical edge and into the autonomous platforms. We've started to build this out, and we're engaged through the Army Warfighter Experimentation Program, and we'll see that being deployed later on this year on Salisbury Plain, and bringing that network to life where there will be those autonomous systems in attendance, but also the wider evolved digital backbone and the headquarters that connect to it. Whilst the network will ensure that your data gets from point A to B, e.g. from sensor to decider to defector, we also need to consider how we connect each of these nodes, these platforms, ensuring operation across a contested and congested electromagnetic environment. We all depend on the electromagnetic spectrum in our everyday lives, whether that's to communicate, access the internet, or listen to music. And we enjoy a myriad of other wireless-enabled capabilities. Our military users do too. They also have requirements to understand, deny, deceive, manipulate, and exploit that spectrum. When it comes to autonomy, we have to maintain a connection in contested environments, even if that's a very low bandwidth connection. We also need to make this connectivity easy to integrate onto any platform, not just our own, and into the wider system. We've developed software-defined radios that do exactly this, ready to be installed in everything from small UAVs to satellites in low Earth orbit. We also work with our customers to make it easy to integrate SEMA, not just as a hardware integrator, but ensuring that the people know how to use it securely, as well as use other systems such as artificial intelligence that can learn how to prevent enemy jamming a comms system, but also how to recognize an enemy signal and automatically apply that jamming. In the context of what we're doing here, there are three main areas sort of to take away. So one is around the connectivity. So as well as providing our own software-defined radios, we also work with a number of different SMEs to try and bring those innovative technologies into play within our uncrewed platforms and look to provide capabilities that are difficult to intercept and detect. Integrating SEMA payloads into platforms, taking the capabilities we have developed for other domains and use cases and refactoring this to support new domains and/or platforms. An example of this might be taking our RF payload designed for our Azalea low Earth orbit satellite and refactoring it to support our high altitude platform, Phaser 35. And finally, using our wider SEMA capability to protect our platforms. This includes elements of defensive cyber, protecting the information and the capability from threats, and the likes of reverse engineering, seeking to duplicate or identify vulnerabilities within our own platforms to providing more offensive counter-uncrewed systems. Finally, in terms of payload development and payload integration, we've worked quite closely over the last 12 months with a UK SME called Sentinel Unmanned to install a laser target designator capability on its uncrewed air system, Long Reach 70. Enabling it to paint targets from the air and sparing personnel this dangerous role, using an airborne laser also means we can paint targets at much greater range, with less chance of being blocked by obstacles if the target is moving. Together with Sentinel, we have already flown Long Reach 70 and fired the laser designator during the British Army's Army Warfighter experimentation last year, which we believe was the first time in the UK that a laser this powerful has been fired from an airborne platform under 25 kilograms. As well as integrating the laser designator and comm systems, BAE Systems has added other features to the Long Reach 70. We've also installed a communications rebroadcast payload, so the Long Reach 70 can act as a comms node to other assets within the area. And we are also looking at integrating radio frequency sensors to help identify enemy broadcasting communications. And we're working to make this multi-role and multi-domain system commercially available. For us, this work is an essential part of the glue that helps our autonomous products share information and act as a team, interact with commanders and crewed platforms, and ultimately deliver decisive advantage. I'll now hand you back to Rob to answer any questions.
Thank you. So hopefully...
Jack Richardson. I'm a freelance journalist with the Royal Aeronautical Society. A couple of questions, if I may. About these Strix, I couldn't help but notice the model on the stand had brimstones attached. So is this now a capability you're offering? And also, regards the LR-70, you say you want it to be commercially available. Have you got a time frame in mind for that?
So the LR-70 is commercially available now. So that's been bid into various requirements for the UK and operations that we're supporting. Strix, currently, the payloads are there conceptual to demonstrate the capability of that platform. So that will undergo a first flight in an all-electric mode very shortly, within the next few months. We then need to change that all-electric propulsion to hybrid electric propulsion to get a meaningful operational range, which will be a further development iteration before we then get into actually offering that as an operational platform with integrated payloads. But the concept, if you look at the payload and the range of a Strix, then delivery of three brimstones over significant range is the kind of capability that platform is designed for, but that's not ready as an operational capability yet.
So could it be maritime as well?
Yes, a lot of the early use cases for Strix look like they're maritime use cases. So we're also looking at parallel developments around landing systems to bring that down onto a moving deck. Those kind of de-risks at the platform level are happening in parallel. But yeah, we very definitely envisage that as potentially a maritime platform.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your time. Hope that's given you a bit of an insight into the products we're developing and the underlying ethos we're taking to develop that capability as we roll forward. So thank you for your time.